Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 5. Chapter 4. Science Number 4, Hypnosis. Hypnosis and the Occult. Understanding the Basics about Hypnosis. The Power of Hypnosis. Understanding the Deeper Mechanics of Hypnosis Intention System Cognitive Demon Processes. Programming Aids Fasting. Using Holograms as an Access Aid. Keeping the Mind in Alpha State. Preparing the Brain. Early Training for Slaves. Magical Training on the Starlight Level. Fine Tuning. The Monarch Programming Script for Over the Rainbow. Deep Trance Programming. Color Programming. The Association of Colorful Sights, Sounds, Rhythm and Dance. Light and Color Elizabeth Clare Prophet. Special Colors. Healing by Correct Vibrations and Rays. Using Hypnosis to Heal the Slave After Abuse. Reinforcing the Programming with a Decognition Process. Hypnotic Codes, Cues, and Triggers Cipher Color Alphanumeric Code. Monarch Mind Control Codes AT. Program Codes during 1972 to 1976 for Dr. Green. The Illuminati. The Network. The Establishment, the System. Hypnosis and the Occult. From the Egyptian sleep temples to ancient shamans, the occult world has been putting hypnosis, including self-hypnosis, to work for centuries, even millennia. During the 18th and 19th century, the Masonic lodges put hypnotism to use. In 1882, Jean-Martin Charcot, considered the world's greatest neurologist at the time, gave hypnotism respectability by publishing his own studies, which included recovering A. trauma memories blocked by amnesia, and B. memories presumed permanently lost by organic amnesia. At that time, a group of French medical doctors located at Nancy just a 100 kilometers southeast of the Mothers of Darkness Castle, had a school of hypnosis that influenced doctors all over the world including Freud. These French doctors had caught on to the power of suggestion to the subconscious. In the 1780s, Marquis de Puysegur was putting people into deep hypnotic trances and then commanding them to forget the hypnotic session. James S. Dale in his book Mesmerism in India and its Practical Application in Surgery and Medicine. Pub. Longman, Brown, Green, Longmans, 1846. Pages XXIIIXXIV, describes and lists hundreds of surgeries, some quite serious, which he did in India using hypnosis as his anesthesia. He found his patients could heal quickly and experienced no pain under hypnosis. In modern medical history, every type of surgery has been successfully carried out without drugs and without pain by using hypnosis. In the Vol. 2 book, it was brought out that perceptive researchers have figured out that the pain under hypnosis is placed by the mind into a dissociated piece of the mind, which is essentially what MPD, DID, is all about. Tests have shown that hypnosis to reduce pain does not work by the brain releasing endorphins, see Hilgard, 1975 and Spiegel and Leonard, 1986. The mind simply diverts the pain into a mental floppy disk that it doesn't look at. In the early 1880s, occult researcher Edmund Gurney found he could give post-hypnotic commands that would be successfully carried out in the future. What amazed him was that subjects would fulfill commands exactly as commanded at a particular time on a particular day without even looking at the clock. Various European doctors, too numerous to mention, discovered in the 1880s that they could cure various diseases via hypnosis. The cure rate was not 100%, but significant enough to make hypnosis an option in some treatments. This author, Fritz, has reported that programmed multiples are able to increase the temperature of one body part, or one side of their body. Cisco, the co-author of this book, when she hits certain programs, turns ice cold on the right of her body and burns on the left side. It was with great interest then when this author located the 1920 work of hypnotist J.A. Hadfield, who published his work in Lancet, 2, pages 68-69, under the title The Influence of Suggestion on Body Temperature. Using hypnosis, Hadfield could get a subject to drop his temperature in one hand to 68.0 while the other hand stayed at 94 degree. Here is the paper trail to what they have been doing to programmed multiples for half a century. Today, the occult world uses sophisticated hypnotic techniques as one of their programming tools to create mind-controlled slaves. The slave's mind is structured into a robotic computer controlled by a master. Parts, alters, of the slave will learn how to trance, self-hypnosis, on cue. The better conditioned a subject is to hypnosis, the easier they fall into trance. The victims of mind control are all very conditioned for hypnosis, even though their programmers then hide that under post-hypnotic suggestions that no one else is to be allowed to hypnotize the slave. The ancient saying is that a picture is worth a thousand words. In conveying suggestions to the subconscious mind, the occult world of black magic and the programmers are very aware of the power that picture images convey. The good programmer will be able to utilize images to give him tremendous leverage in hypnotic techniques. An altar which needs to create something in the mind can be prepped with images, and can be asked to borrow images, such as borrow such and such quality from this person or animal. The child altar who becomes a lion after eating a dead lion's parts can imagine the qualities, speed, agility, fierceness, of the lion easily. The image of the lion is worth a thousand words to the hypnotic programmer. If the programmer wants an alter that is trained in karate to be agile, quick, and fierce, they don't mind dehumanizing that alter to become a lion or tiger. One element of why this is done is the power of the image for hypnotic commands. The deeper Illuminati alters will be highly skilled in self-hypnosis and the ability to change at will into various states of consciousness. This is part of their witchcraft training in order to practice witchcraft. Understanding the basics about hypnosis. The programmer is attempting to produce suggestions that the unconscious mind will accept. If the subconscious mind accepts the programmer's suggestions, then the suggestion becomes reality to the victim, just as if the victim had experienced it as reality over a period of time. The programmer, if he is good, will be able to get the subject's imagination involved. He will also build rapport with his victim. For instance, the master might hypnotically stroke the forehead of kitten sexual alters before giving them their code to go back into the mind. The good handler slash programmer is not simply working off of fear, but he wants to have the trust and cooperation of the victim. This is similar to how Hitler was both feared and trusted by the German masses. In fact, hypnosis was an element in Hitler's control of the masses. Nazi propaganda films showing Hitler and other Nazi leaders giving directives always have the Hitler Youth's actions slightly speeded up so that subconsciously the viewer is taught obedience to their commands. The programmer will not tell the slave something is hypnotically happening until it has already happened. He will use the art of timing his words at the correct time, of using repetition, of combining several mutually supporting suggestions, and of having total confidence in his words to add strength to his hypnotic commands. Muscular rigidity and deep breathing are one way to increase suggestibility within the victim being programmed via hypnosis. The programmer will also use other hypnotic tricks, such using his own body language to suggest something, and to use what is called a voice role. When the programmer moves his voice into a monotonous pattern style, he is using the role voice. Words are delivered at the rate of 45 to 60 beats a minute. To empower the suggestions, the programming hypnotist uses the victim's five senses. The victim visualizes something using his five senses, such as the imagery of the Holy Spirit, done in mockery of God, and then breathes this imagery in. For instance, the victim breathes in the message of the programming and roots it deep down into the oak tree. In Vol 2, it was explained that the oak tree is the structure that the programs are attached to. The power of hypnosis. During the hypnotic trance, the human mind is at the pinnacle of its ability to quickly learn. What might take years to learn and weighing the evidence, will be accepted quickly by the victim's subconscious. The mind strings together a series of cognitive mental demons. That is a series of mental processes similar to how a computer programmer writes a program. These strings have been called K-lines. Much of what the mind does is simply activations of various kaolins, a habitual ways of doing things, so that the mind can focus its limited conscious thinking. The mind also takes micronemes, such things as a particular aroma, or a particular intonation for which it has no word, but for which it has a series of sensory clues, and builds these into kaolins too. Once a kaolin works, the mind, in order to prevent itself from making reckless changes, gives priority to those kaolins. Under hypnosis, the mind willingly allows the hypnotist to change kaolins without the normal unconscious conservative restraints. Under behavior modification techniques, abnormal kaolins, that is kaolins that wouldn't normally develop, can be forced into the mind. A hypnotic suggestion given to normal subjects lasts about a week, so reinforcement is helpful. The programming suggestions are layered in using methods far more powerful than mere hypnosis, and are locked up in dissociated subconscious states, so that these programming scripts which are layered in are almost impossible for the victim to be aware of to challenge them. The emotions of women have been found to slightly detract from the hypnotic trance, while male victims take the hypnotic words in an unemotional matter-of-fact way. The male victims will simply accept the programming and directly comply. That is one reason why the suicide programs that are layered into the men are so deadly. The female victims of programming may emotionally play the suicide out and survive. The male slaves, when they trigger suicide programs, comply with the programming in an unemotional direct way. How deep is the slave's trance? There are tests for trance depths, but from what this author can ascertain, sometimes it can be difficult to determine exactly where the mind is at. If a memory is laid in at a particular trance level, the slave may be able to avoid an abreaction later on by going above or below the memory's trance level. A deep level, where for instance, the person can't move a body part due to hypnotic suggestion, would be called the cataleptic stage or level. Understanding the deeper mechanics of hypnosis. Let us suppose for the sake of discussion that as you are reading this, it is supper time. You are hungry. You've starved yourself all day, and even though you are on a strict diet, you are trying to think of a good restaurant to go to. Now let's see, as your mind scans the different possibilities, it thinks of some that are close, some that are quick. Some that have lots of easy parking and others that have good-looking waitresses. Mechanically, your thought processes went like this. A. Particular sensations and chemicals cause the mind to feel what it mentally describes as a pang of hunger. This is perceived as an important need. B. The mind has a process that we can call an intention system that creates specific intention messages that are sent throughout the brain. It stores these intentions temporarily. If an intention is not freshly created and rest act at the top of the clutter of intentions in the intention store, then it gets buried underneath the mind cluttered desk of things to do and forgotten. In our example, the mind is searching its memory banks for options on how to satisfy its hunger. C. The mind must decide upon one particular course of action. The mind quits focusing on other matters, and concentrates upon deciding which course of action to take. The mind has now activated all kinds of what some researchers call demons. Because we are not talking about spiritual demons, but rather we are referring to units of cognitive processes which are very similar to Unix computer demons, we will refer to these demons by the name cognitive demon processes. Some of these cognitive demon processes are action demons and some are word demons, and some are recognition demons. Recognition cognitive demon processes go running through the mind, shouting the wishes of the intention store. A number of lower-level cognitive demon processes wake up and make themselves known if they identify with what the recognition demon is shouting about. Many may think they match the request, but other demon processes check them out to see how close they match. Now the checkers come up with a list of cognitive demon processes who are concerned with eating at restaurants, who have woken up and are all scrambling for attention. Cognitive demon processes establish themselves in families, and develop relationships that are automatic. Cognitive demons do not die, but some go to sleep and others can get somewhat rusty in their relationships. The demons that respond to the shouting of our recognition demon go through a series of interviews with the hierarchy of other demon processes, and soon the messenger demon can rush back to the intention store with the name of the choices available. All this happens extremely quick. If the mind did not set up a series of automatic cognitive demon processes that become habits, called K-lines, it would find itself involved in the conscious relearning of trivial matters that would make it impossible to get much accomplished. Every skill would have to be constantly relearned. A person might easily end up spending all day dressing. As long as the mind remains in a static environment, where habits work, it's great. But life is such a changing environment, that our entrenched habits can cause the mind to pull up a cognitive demonic process out of habit, when it is neither wanted nor appropriate. Emotions and needs, which are tied to our emotions, will trigger the mind to search out cognitive demon processes. For instance, if our emotional need for someone we are looking for is great, let's say a wife waiting for a long-expected war husband, it may send a need down the brain for the cognitive demons that are attached to the identification of the long-awaited person, and the mind triggers itself to see his face in the crowd at the busy railway station before its owner arrives. Cognitive demon processes live in close proximity to other demons, and when one gets excited, others in the area do too, although their excitement may be much less. If a cognitive demon is being used a great deal, it will be on its toes, but little used demons can go to sleep, and somehow need to be hollowed at very loud to wake up. The intention system after a while will set itself on autopilot for certain mental functions, which frees the conscious mind for other problems. The conscious mind can only focus on a small amount of material. It is like a computer which has limited memory. It is constantly in a state of redeployment, and the intention system has only a small sway over how the attention part of the mind decides to focus. The attention part constantly asks itself, which tasks can be relegated to habit. Then when the intention system sends out cognitive search demons, they do not have to involve the conscious mind, because everything that is habitual is set up like a script, with families of cognitive demon processes already knowing the roles/relationships they are to play. Again, behavior modification is used to strengthen the relationships of demonic processes, and to make some well used and awake, so that certain behaviors become habits. When our minds meditate or go into a hypnotic trance, what is occurring is that our conscious mind is delegating its limited computing memory for the focus of its attention upon one object. What happens to the cognitive demon processes that would normally take instructions from the conscious mind? During meditation, the untrained cognitive demon processes bubble up to the top of the conscious mind. However, the opposite happens during hypnosis. During hypnosis, the mind has made the decision, for whatever reasons, to accept control statements from the hypnotist. The mind has surrendered or at least temporarily or partially abdicated his or her position as the master of his or her intention system. Some of this power is given away. The hypnotist now has access and control over many or all the cognitive demonic processes, including some that the person would not normally activate. Cognitive demon processes that are asleep or deeply buried can be accessed by the hypnotist, in a much quicker direct way than the intention system would. By suggesting that the subject has a cat on his lap, the hypnotist is actually causing the recognition cognitive demon processes to wake up and act out their jobs to such an extent that the subject sees a cat. By suggesting that the subject's body stiffen, the hypnotist has gained control over those cognitive action demons that cause the body to stiffen. Age regression brings up demons that are associated with the subject's childhood. Although it is unpopular to admit publicly that the hypnotist has power over the subject, a close look at the process of how hypnosis works at the neuronal cognitive demon process level shows that the hypnotist has indeed been given power. In fact, the hypnotist has been given power to activate cognitive units of demon processes that the mind itself would allow to remain inactive or asleep. The mind would not normally use its ability to activate them. Today, it is politically incorrect to admit that the hypnotist has power to make an individual do what they wouldn't normally want to do, but unfortunately hypnosis does give this power. Programming aids. Because the programmers control the slave's life to such a high degree, they can add other elements that move the brain into programmable states. Fasting along with a high sugar intake will make the brain more suggestive. The military also used this in basic training. This was done to this author at West Point during Beast Barracks, where during the first 2 weeks he ate all total enough food for one regular meal. However, new cadets were allowed to go to chapel and eat all the brownies, cookies, and Kool-Aid they wanted. Physical discomforts and the chanting of rituals in witchcraft ceremonies are also ways to move the mind into programming states. Lights, sounds, for instance repetitive beats such as with any rock music, and smells are all used to encourage the brain to go into a programmable state. In the chapter on electronics, it discusses how the functions of the mind-body such as breathing and the heartbeat can be regulated by external stimuli, that is lights and sounds which are electronically produced. If the repetitive beat is ranged between 45 to 72 beats per minute, many people will go into a programmable state with their eyes open. This is because this beat is close to the beat of the heart in a relaxed state. Some secret illum. Programming centers have areas that are constructed for the greatest hypnotic sound and lighting effect. The child slash or adult victim is cut off from the world at these programming centers. The victim's freedom to walk outside into normal life depends upon their cooperation with the programmer's. Lullaby music is used as a cue for some alters of slaves to induce trance when their systems are older, because the child alters still respond to the cue. Anything can be a cue, but it appears the programmers often pick cues that are naturally reinforced by the mind. The lullaby or carousel music is a good cue, because the lullaby is taking advantage of the natural desire of the brain to retreat from reality to the nostalgia of childhood fun. The retreat of the mind to childhood naturally evokes the helplessness and dependence that a child feels. The programmers are powerful enough to place in cues that don't need natural reinforcement, but from observation it is apparent that they will often skillfully strengthen the hypnotic power by the choice of a cue which carries its own natural reinforcement. One supporting element in programming is that the programmer sets himself up as God, the creator of the victim, or an alien of a far advanced race. In hypnotism, this fulfills the need that all hypnotic subjects must have faith and trust in their hypnotist. Hypnosis is subjective in nature. If the programmer is the creator of the alter being programmed, and the alter is additionally under a hypnotic drug that makes it willing to obey, it is easy to see how the victim lets go of all inhibitions, because God or this superior alien knows what is best. The better and stronger the relationship between the victim and his master programmer, the better the hypnotic commands work. If the slave sees the master as a religious guru prophet, or a great doctor, it enhances his willingness to accept hypnotic commands. Bear in mind that the slave is conditioned to love their master without reservation. Yes, the benevolent dictator has historically received the devotion of the masses, and many of the Illuminati programmers are actually simply egotistical sadists. Using holograms as an access aid. The Illuminati is now even resorting to creating talking hologram images to access their slaves with their hypnotic cues. Keeping the mind in alpha state. The entire alter system of a monarch slave has their sleep patterns controlled. Many alters are programmed not to get real sleep. They actually sleep in a hypnotic alpha state sleep, or what may be called trance sleep. Hypnotists, and brain researchers, will tell you that true sleep and a hypnotic sleep are not the same thing for the brain. Some alters, but not many, must stay awake 24 hours a day internally and carefully watch all that happens in the system of alters. Someone has to take the body and sleep, but whichever alters are set up to do it, they are hypnotically commanded to only sleep about 3 hours to ensure that the mind stays in an alpha state easy to program. Because alters which do not hold the body rest mentally, in a sense when they take the body they are fresh. The mind dissociates when it is given unpleasant things to hear which it doesn't want to hear. The electronic implants that send voices to victims are used to create dissociation within the slaves, plus certain implants and devices send specific electromagnetic wave patterns to the mind to put the slave's mind into the alpha state. See Chapter 6 for more on the mind control implants. Preparing the brain. The programmer places the victim in an acute state of anxiety and guilt. The tension reduces the power of the judgment part of the mind. One of the tortures for slaves is to keep them from going to the bathroom and relieving themselves. This is part of the hypnotic programming package. The anxiety that this creates increases the power of the programming in the brain, because the anxiety causes slight malfunctions with the brain's judgment abilities. Mental and physical fatigue are also sought in the victim. For instance, water deprivation is common. This was also done to the author at West Point, where one of this author's classmates was hospitalized for dehydration during Beast Barracks. Offensive language also helps drive the mind into tension and encourages it into an alpha state. Early training for slaves. The children who are being programmed are taught four important hypnotic abilities. These four abilities are A. relaxation, B. visualization, C. concentration, and D. projection, which work in handling the slave along with the alpha state. Relaxation and visualization go hand in hand, each enhancing each other. When given a good pleasant image to visualize, the victim relaxes, which leads to the hypnotic concentration, which then produces good projection. Initially, the child victim is given drugs that induce euphoria and deep relaxation. They are then taught to work toward that drug euphoria by going to it mentally. They develop the ability to go into that euphoria mentally as a trained behavior. Many of the children will have their training in visualization and concentration reinforced when they go to public schools, many of which are now involved in the programming process. To teach the child concentration and visualization, the child is given an apple and trained to visualize it. The first time, the child will be given drugs which will enhance the experience and perception greatly to around 100 times the perception without the drugs. There is no pain involved in this early programming at around the age of 3 or 4. After the child has gone through the visualization of the apple in the drugged state, he or she will work toward the mental ability to visualize it intensely without the drugs. The visualization script used with the apple, in both the drugged and undrugged exercises, will vary slightly from programmer to programmer, yet will be close to the following. Visualize an apple. Hold it in your hands. Turn it around, feel it. Feel the shape, the size, the weight, the texture. Notice the color, the reflection of light on its skin. Bring it to your nose and smell it. Bite into it, taste it, hear the crunch as your teeth sink in. Eat the apple, feel it slide down your throat. See it grow smaller. When you have eaten it down to the core, let it disappear. By the way, an apple training incident very similar to this, which is given by the Illuminati to child slaves from the ages 2 to 4, strangely turned up occurring in a setting that the author, who never was a slave nor never in the occult, found himself in when this author was a 4-H counselor at a 4-H camp as a 16-year-old. The first thing all the counselors were given was an apple exercise so that we could appreciate each camper for what he or she was. The person who led the exercise was a psychologist. Where had he learned it? The apple visualization must be done to a standard of excellence by the child victim. The victim's life depends upon learning to visualize vividly, so that the internal structures, internal mental images, it builds within the mind will stay strong and firm. The programmers want the child to have good visualization, so they will work with the child to have the most successful experience. For instance, the child will be offered a variety of apples to look at, yellow, green, red, etc. The child can choose the apple that it likes so that its visualization exercises will be the most successful. The entire imagery of an internal system will be built upon the foundation of the child's ability to visualize an apple. The child will be taken through a succession of exercises where the child learns to visualize the apple in greater and greater detail using all the senses. Eventually, the child is able to visualize his or her apple to the point that the child can dissect or chop the apple up in any way and reconstruct it mentally. The internal seeds of the apple can be seen brilliantly by the child. Upon this ability to visualize, the programmer will then teach the child that the apple can become anything the child wants, a river, a couch, a book, etc. the five seeds of the apple will be turned into five castles. This is why essentially all Illuminati mind-controlled slaves have five major castles in their system of programming. One approach by therapists has been to cast out/remove the castles. However, the castle imagery is based upon the apple seeds, which is based on the apple. The real thing to deal with for therapists is the apple. If the castle is returned to its original image of being an apple seed, and the rest of the apple and its tree imagery dealt with, then some progress can be made. Unfortunately, not being aware of the original imagery, the therapists have been frustrating themselves with the superficial imagery rather than the foundational imagery. Another script for teaching the young 2 to 4 year old slave simple visualization is to have the child close his or her eyes and imagine that they are looking at a white wall or blank screen. Then they practice visualizing simple geometric shapes, and then visualize the screen in different colors, and then finally visualize the objects changing colors. Magical training on the starlight level. The Illuminati begin training the child victim to work at the starlight level. This is called magical training. The child's abilities to relax, visualize, concentrate, and project are then harnessed in the alpha state by magical training, which opens up the starlight consciousness. Starlight consciousness is the other way of knowing that which belongs to the right hemisphere, and it allows the victim to make contact with the divine within. The divine within the victim is actually the generational spirits, which are placed in during the moon child ceremonies described in detail in Volume 2. The generational spirits are laid in to help build the programming and to guard it. However, as in so much spiritual work, the victims, technically speaking, the altars, will and thoughts work hand in hand with the spirits. The child must learn to visualize and participate in the mental building of the internal worlds, structures, etc. However, the demons will be strategically placed to protect the structures once the programming is built into the mind. For more understanding of this, see Cisco's section on programming, foundational, destruction of dot. Fine-tuning. The child victim's mind is fine-tuned. This means that the child can function excellently at visualization, relaxation, concentration, projection, while in the alpha state and can work with their subconscious mind. The mental work done in the subconscious cannot be retrieved easily. Only through outside assistance or special training can most people access what is done at the starlight level of the mind. The programmers are using the child's abilities with its five acute senses to develop the sixth sense, which is its ability to work in the starlight consciousness, which includes such mental activity such as psychic abilities, which will be discussed in other locations in this book. Enhancing the mind so that it can work in the subconscious area called the starlight consciousness is referred to by many insiders as astral. The monarch programming script for over the rainbow. One of the most important concepts of the programmers is having slaves go over the rainbow. Although in recent years other methods have been substituted for this, there are many hundreds of thousands of slaves for whom going over the rainbow is part of their programming. What is the script for programming this? The programming script for going over the rainbow. Three dots in this script do not indicate missing parts, but rather pauses. In other words, pauses are indicated by three dots. Induction training script. Breathe deep - you are floating down. Down. On a beautiful red cloud, and your whole body is red as you go drifting and floating. Rocking gently. Deeper. And deeper. Down. This repeated, one time, for each color of cloud: orange, yellow, green, blue, and violet clouds. Land very gently. Very softly. In the center of a round, black pearl. See it glowing, softly, gently. Now turn and face the east. And then the south. And then the west. And then the north. Open all of your inner senses. The rainbow gives the much abused victim of mind control and trauma a safe mental place to travel to, and this serves as a home base for the mind to return to when things get difficult. If the programming begins to be destroyed and a deeper alter experiences real life, its coping mechanism to face the harsher realities of life will be a knee-jerk reaction to go to safety over the rainbow. bringing the slave out of trance, switching to the front personalities after programming. After the slave has been switched to deeper personalities who are in trance in order to have the slave A be programmed, B be programmed and carry out a mission, C go to a ritual, then it is important that the programmer takes time to get the slave to emerge slowly and gently from their altered state. The induction process is reversed. The repetition of trances will reinforce the depth of the trance state, and keep the undetectable slavery operating smoothly. In the pearl, prepare to awaken. When you awake, you will feel refreshed, alert, renewed, and filled with energy. You will remember all that you have experienced. Now turn and face the east. Then the south. Then the west. Then the north. This helps the slave orient themselves internally. Take a deep breath. Inhale. Exhale. You are floating up. Up. On a beautiful violet cloud, and your whole body is violet as you drift gently upward. On a beautiful blue cloud. Up. Up. And your whole body is blue and you are beginning to awaken gently and you drift gently up. On a beautiful green cloud. And your whole body is green. As you drift gently. Up. Up. On a beautiful yellow cloud. Getting more and more awake. And your whole body is yellow. As you drift gently. Up. Up. On a beautiful orange cloud. Filled with energy and vitality. Your whole body is orange. As you float up gently. On a beautiful red cloud. Almost fully awake now. And your whole body is red as you float gently. Stay on the rainbow. At this point the script for the slave's programming or mission or ritual will be placed into the mind. After the programming session, the mission, or the ritual the handler slash or programmer finishes. Leaving the memory in the black pearl and closing and sealing the black pearl. You will remember only those details that I tell you to remember. And in a moment you will count to 10 and go back into your space, and read 2001A whatever the code is for the altar will return. Deep trance programming. If we rate trance depths on a scale of 1 to 13, then the deep trance that is being described here is 7 to 10. At this 7 to 10 depth, the person must be constantly watched. The victim is turned on his side so that the victim will continue to breathe. If the person monitoring has doubts whether the slave is alive, the programming staff will poke the lungs and neck. The person's breathing will be encouraged by the programmer breathing along with the person being programmed as he says breathe. 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 This is important because at this level the slave is so tranced their body can forget to breathe. Color programming. While we are still on the subject of the rainbow and its colors, and before we continue on to other parts of the hypnotic programming process, let's deal with color programming. When Illuminati slaves are being programmed as little children, they usually will get music and color programming. Most readers are like this author, in that they are not interested in learning magic. However, because this author, Fritz Springmeier, was interested in helping victims understand what's been done to them, it was important to dive into trying to understand the thinking of the occult world in regards to colors. If I write that the occult world views yellow as a healing color, and blue as a relaxing color, and purple, violet, as a spiritually enlightened color, that is not because I want to teach that as a doctrine, but so that therapists can begin to understand the hidden mannerisms and thought patterns of these powerful generational occult families, who believe in such odd practices as child sacrifice. In the 1940s, as the Illuminati were applying scientific investigation to their ancient skills in mind control, a number of researchers investigated color psychology. Cecil Stokes' color research on the influence of colors on the mind led to the Oratone films, which were used to treat the mentally ill. Walt Disney Studios produced one of the best occult attempts to free associate color, light, and music in their movie Fantasia, especially Fantasia's opening selection of Stokowski's adaptation of Bach's Toccata and Fugue in D minor. Walt Disney also used selections of music from the Satanist composer Igor Stravinsky in Fantasia. Igor Stravinsky is an anarchy-espousing Satanist. Fantasia was a long labor of occult devotion for Walt Disney and his studios. It took many years to create the film, and when it was finished, it was used as a programming foundation for Alter Systems. Chapter 5 will have more on Disney. Chapter 5 will also give a very detailed script for how Fantasia has been used as the primary foundation programming tool. Disney's Dick Tracy movie is also a classic example of how color is employed in a movie which is used covertly for mind control programming. The five primary areas of occult thinking that were investigated by this author in terms of color programming were: 1. Witchcraft books such as Raymond Buckland's Practical Color Magic. 2. An extensive study of several New Age groups such as the I Am Movement, and Church Universal and Triumphant, cut, using hundreds of documents that ex-insiders of these groups provided. 3. Masonic and Rosicrucian sources, such as Manly P. Hall's book The Secret Teachings of All Ages, and 4. Metaphysical books in general such as the excellent The Rainbow Book, being a collection of essays and illustrations devoted to rainbows in particular and spectral sequences in general, focusing on the meaning of color, physical and metaphysically, from ancient to modern times. The Rainbow Book was done by the Fine Arts Museums of San Francisco in association with Shamhala of Berkeley and London, 1975. And finally, the last primary source but not least was interviews with an ex-programmer. What did I find out? After lots of weeding, I have some siftings from these sources to share. In Buckland's Practical Color Magic, we learn about a type of voodoo called puppet dolls. These dolls are made according to the color that is appropriate for the person's problem. For instance, they make a green puppet doll if the person needs help with finances. The name of the person is written on the doll according to the color that corresponds to their astrological birth date. For instance, Leo is orange, and Pisces is indigo. Those who need success are advised by Buckland to make a color treasure map, which is simply a collage of the things they want, making sure that the pictures are bright colors. This is another example of color magic. Buckland provides a color number code as follows: 1 equals red, 2 equals orange, 3 equals yellow, 4 equals green, 5 equals blue, 6 equals indigo, 7 equals violet, 8 equals rose, 9 equals gold. The letters of the alphabet then are corresponded to these 9 numbers, and by adding up the numbers in someone's name, numerology, Buckland tells us we can get the name's color from such a process. What did I learn of value from Buckland? Some tips on how occultists assign colors to numbers and objects. For the average person, these witchcraft teachings are simply trite imaginations. Even so, the fact remains for those of us confronting occult mind control, colors are important to total mind control programmers of the Illuminati. Colors are important to their worldview. A programmer who knew color magic would likely use color magic in their programming scripts and codes. Now, both you and I know some more about how to second-guess the programmer's mind. By the way, color programming was dealt with in a major way in Volume 2, but the tips in this chapter may also be useful. The association of colorful sights, sounds, rhythm and dance. Dance has been associated with color from ancient times, to Greek and medieval courts up to modern times with the use of colored floodlights. Keys in music have been associated with colors by many famous musicians. Beethoven referred to B minor as the black key. Schubert compared E minor to a girl robed in white with a rose-red bow on her breast. Rimsky-Korsakov interpreted the keys of C, D, A, F, and F sharp major as white, yellow, rosy, green, and grayish green. Handel had his own idea of how the keys related to the colors. The brighter hues of a color have been associated by some with the major scale, and the more subdued hues of a color with the minor. Goethe stated that a painting of powerful effect was like a piece of music with a sharp key, while a painting with a muted effect was like music in a flat key. Certain colors have been associated with violin music. In Vasily Kandinsky's book The Art of Spiritual Harmony, we learn a great deal about color and music. The following comes from Kandinsky's observations, and may relate to Menschel's programming. The ringing notes of a violin have been associated with a cool red. The largo of an old violin is associated with orange. The placid middle tones of the violin are associated with absolute green. A dark blue is like a cello. White is like the pauses in music that temporarily break the melody. Black represents the final pauses, after which any continuation of melody see the dawn of another world. The Rainbow Book is definitely the most comprehensive book this author has seen on the significance of color both physically and metaphysically. An interesting chart is given on page 125, which examines the relationship of the frequencies of electromagnetic waves in the visible light spectrum with an octave of music just above middle C. In order to make the comparison, which is charted below, the light frequencies which are 1012 are written without the powers of 10 and taken down 40 to match the note octaves. This gives us a chart which we will arrange by color/ORIG. FREK, 40/octave FREK/note. Using this arrangement we get very dark red /391.3 equals 392/G note, darkish red /418 equals 415/G hashtag note, orangish red /445/440/a note, light orange /464 equals 466/a hashtag note, yellow green /495 equals 494/b note, green /523 equals 523/c note, bluish green /555 equals 553/c sharp note, indigo /573-600 equals 587/d note, indigo violet light violet /618-627 equals D hashtag note, dark violet /655-673 equals 659/E note, very dark violet /682 equals 698/F note. Although there is no single one-to-one correspondence between music and color, because there are different patterns to consider and the role of association is such a complex issue, there are several things that naturally suggest themselves. An increase in pitch does seem to suggest an increase in brightness. An increase in brightness also is suggested by an increase in tempo. Colors also fit the mood of a piece of music. A mass of color can suggest the musical ground. Musical intervals have also been related by the ancients to the orbits of the planets. This began with the spherical theory of the cosmos by Pythagoras, where the different astrological bodies made different sounds. Another correspondence with merit is to associate colors with properties, and then associate with music intervals, then association with related chords, and related planets, and then associate with other things. For instance, orange would be associated with the sun, energy, glory, and power. In turn, it would be associated with re, pronounced re in music, the whole tone, D. Its related chord would be minor, and its related planet would be the sun Apollo. Violet would be death, separation, advanced spirituality. It would be associated with T, in music, the major seventh, B, and its related planet would be the moon Diana. There is no way all the different associations can be reviewed here. The Chinese have had a number of music color association schemes, as well as the Hindis, the Tibetans, and others. Is this section on color going somewhere with these associations? Yes, Joseph Menschel, the original Dr. Green, the name Green got passed on to at least one of his proteges, played the violin and piano while doing the color programming to slaves. He was the original master at associating both a tone or chord with a particular color or color scheme. He loved using fantasia for programming. Light and color. According to Hilton Odom's book Ancient Sun God, Mokalumni Hill CA, Health Research, 1956, light and fire are associated with sun worship. Pyra is Greek for fire, and Medos means measure. Pyramid is a combination of the Greek words pyra and Medos, which together meant light measures. In other words, the pyramid was the eternal ascending flame, the spark returning to its maker. The eternal flame of Prometheus is a recurrent theme within all the modern revolutions, which by the way were all created secretly by the occult hierarchy. The Tower of Babel most likely followed the pattern which the ancient Babylonian cylinders say was used by the Babylonians in building their temples. Each level was dedicated to one of the seven planets, and was built in that color. In other words, the Tower of Babel looked like a rainbow. The lowest was to Saturn and was black. The next was to Jupiter and was orange. The next was to Mars and was red. The fourth was the Sun and was yellow. The fifth was Venus and was green. The sixth was Mercury and was blue, and the top or seventh level would be white. A good example of color programming and a New Age group which is involved with Illuminati/government mind control is Church Universal and Triumphant. In the Covert Action Information Bulletin, number 30, Summer, 1988, Church Universal and Triumphant was exposed as a conduit of CIA funds. Another clue as to how CUT connects in is that Elizabeth Clare Prophet, CUT's prophetess, speaks in Masonic emplies. E.C. Prophet claims she is Marie Antoinette. One of the first Illuminati programs that this author ran into when working with programmed multiples was Marie Antoinette programming. Another obvious CIA asset, who is not part of CUT, has been directing implant victims to go to CUT and solve their implant problem by seeking the I Am force within them. The I Am is a system programmed into slaves. Initiates into CUT have received a letter, Keeper of the Flame, the need for harmony and love between all the master's servants united in a common effort cannot be overemphasized. Working and serving together, we form a mandala of light through which the masters of the Great White Brotherhood will awaken humanity. Quote from a letter by CUT Chairman of the Outreach Committee Michael Vays to CUT's Fraternity of the Keepers of the Flame, c. 1980. Elizabeth Clare Prophet's Fraternity of Keepers of the Flame, as she calls her initiates, learn such things as astrology, crystals, white magic, color magic, Hinduism, reincarnation, karma, meditation, chakra points, how to decree, how to dress, for instance what color to wear at what time, and how to become divine at Summit University. Elizabeth Clare Prophet, that's the name she wanted, established Summit University, and CUT's headquarters in Colorado Springs, a house in Santa Barbara, and an underground fortress for the end times in a valley in Montana. Details about Elizabeth Clare Prophet and her organization are hard to come by. If a person gets serious about being part of her organization, they are expected to make a once-in-a-lifetime gift of everything they have to the CUT and its head Elizabeth Clare Prophet. Sources, notes, Summit University student and confidential interview. After that they are expected to tithe, 1/10. Church Universal and Triumphant Tenets, Colorado Springs Co., 1975, p.12 under Art. 12 Law of the Tithe. In return, they are initiated into what I call the Supreme Grand Flattery, you shall become an enlightened God. One of the programming tricks by the mind control programmers is to have some of the altars, including front altars, believe that they are divine gods. Although members are told they are divine, when people on EC Prophet's staff got revelations from the Ascended Masters that she channels, she threatened to expel them if they talked about their revelations. EC Prophet does not want anyone else to prophesy in her organization. CUT makes their mind-controlled slaves think that they are too smart and intuitive to ever be deceived. In this way, they use New Age ideas and the person's pride to blind them to the fact the person is a mind-controlled slave who is fooled much of the time. When students are invited onto staff, it is a commitment. They are told, your life will never be your own again, but was it ever your own? They have already been taught ascension keys. Elizabeth Clare Prophet tells her students that to ascend to Godhead is their birthright, the divine right of every person. See Pearls of Wisdom, Volume X, Number 23, June 4, 1967, The Summit Lighthouse, p. 41- has robbed men of the birthright of their ascension. This matches what the Illuminati teach their people. See also Pearls of Wisdom, Volume X, Number 19, May 7, 1967, The Summit Lighthouse, p. 24, The Divine Right is the Immortal Plan, Inherent Pattern of Unique Christ Manifestation. In the Ascension Dossier of Serapis Bay, initiates are told the capacity of the externalized self must be given in toto. Also, you must abandon your past to God. In Lainalo's message, a channeled message, April 20, 73, the students are told, you do not have to wait for the carnal mind to evolve, for the carnal mind will never evolve. It must be put off and cast into the flame. See Lainalo, April 20, 73, in The Pearls of Wisdom, Volume 16, Number 32, 8/12/1973. After emptying themselves of all their past and of what they knew, the initiates are then restructured by cut. In Serapis, Ascension class, they are told, the Ascension flame is the flame of Mother. Special colors. It can't be overemphasized that green is the highest color in Satanism. It is Satan's color. It is not by accident that green has been used in uniforms, although the decision also was dictated by its advantage in camouflage. In the Omega computer programming, a code green for many victims means self-destruct, the ultimate sacrifice for one's satanic programming. Interviews with witches, as well as a person in witchcraft who the Masons tried to recruit, and an ex-member of CUT, and an ex-member of similar New Age group called the I Am Movement, reveals that they all wear special colors of clothes on certain days. Due to the large influx of new converts, it has been difficult for CUT to keep up the teachings on wearing different colored clothing during different times of the day, and for different days. Newer converts may be unaware of this teaching. The colors of purple and white are especially esteemed. The magical properties that Masons and New Agers believe are intrinsic to purple is why the 33rd degree has written books using purple, and several New Agers have published books on purple paper. The programmers also manipulate such things so that child altars believe that color magic has accomplished things. Healing by correct vibrations and rays. Masonic sources match CUT teachings. The second method of healing was by vibration. The inharmonies of the bodies were neutralized by chanting spells and intoning the sacred names, or by playing upon musical instruments and singing. Sometimes articles of various colors were exposed to the sight of the sick, for the ancients recognized, at least in part, the principle of color therapeutics, now in the process of rediscovery. Masonic Hermetic Kabbalistic and Rosicrucian Symbolical Philosophy, p. Cxi. 50. The force of the obligation is therefore in the obligation and not in the reason. As a matter of fact, the real reason is scientific to the last analysis, scientific to a degree beyond the penetration, up to the present time, of the radiant matter of the Rntgen ray of modern science. The word concerns the science of rhythmic vibrations, and is the key to the equilibrium of all forces and to the harmony of eternal nature. Ancient Mystic Oriental Masonry, p.48. Using hypnosis to heal the slave after abuse. Sometimes the handlers trade down the symptoms that result from abuse so that the slave will heal quicker, others attempt to remove the symptoms immediately. For burns, the hypnotist can suggest cooling. For other injuries, suggestions for warmth are applied. For bleeding, suggestions for stopping blood flow are used. Reinforcing the programming with a decognition process. The programmer has gotten the results that he wants via drugs, torture, hypnosis, and deception. Now he must build in back UPS to ensure the programming holds up. The decognition process has three steps. Step 1 is to program the slave to get inadequate sleep, eat poorly, and work hard. It is called reduction of alertness. Step 2 is to create confusion in the mind via programmed confusion using a series of alters. The person may go into revolving from one alter to another, or may have alters coming and going with conflicting messages so that the person remains in a programmed confused state. In military training, conflicting orders would be rapidly issued to confuse the mind. Step 3 is to cause the mind to have something simple to focus on so that it goes into a flat state. In the military, this author became aware that the beat of the drum and marching would shift the mind to a flat state. For centuries, the military have known that they could shut off the critical thinking of the mind and put their soldiers into a flat, non-thinking state by training them to the beat of the drum and the sound of marching feet. Now you know why those British redcoats marched so non-thinking into the barrels of American guns in battles such as New Orleans and Bunker Hill. The mind feels good to shift into this simple flat state. The brain quits thinking and withdraws into a state that it quits thinking except for what the controllers want it to think. This is why marching has been so important in military training. Chanting and singing will also move the mind into this flat state, which is why the French Foreign Legion requires its men to sing, sing, sing. When this author lived in the Indian subcontinent, I saw Hindu holy men who had meditated in a flat alpha state so long their brains no longer functioned in anything but a flat state. This non-thinking flat state is believed by Hindus to be nirvana, but God didn't give us minds to throw away and waste, but to use. He gave us independent thoughts so that we could show our love for Him by choosing to love Him. God didn't want brainwashed followers, which is what some of the churches think God is calling for. The programmers can induce a mood or state of mind hypnotically which will make retrieval of something learned dependent upon going into that particular mood or state. And the beat goes on. It is clear that some of the psychologists have not got wind that the mind control is being exposed. The American Journal of Clinical Hypnosis had a recent article, October 1996, p. 105-114, promoting the use of the Wizard of Oz metaphor in hypnosis with treatment-resistant children. For a therapist/hypnotist to hypnotically use Wizard of Oz material on child victims of mind control will get a response from them. The authors of the article say that they use the authoritarian approach to hypnosis, p. 107, for treatment-resistant children. The Wizard of Oz metaphor is given on page 108 of the article, which boils down to, the straw man, tin man, lion, Dorothy, and Toto were surprised at their success and that they already had brains, a heart, and courage.